Would you like to know more?
Welcome to the Warmaster Podcast, episode 9 of Adventures in 3D Printing. And for those of you in the knowledge, this you will recognise as REFP print, which is a resin exposure test print. So you print a series of the same model, effectively. And the test print came pre-sliced at 0.8 seconds exposure per run of the model. So the first one is 0.8, second one is 1.6, which is this fellow here. And the third one is 2.4, next one is 3.2 seconds. And it goes on until it's printed 8. And then what you do is it used quite a lot of resin. Considering how little resin I use when I do my little 10mm and 6mm models, this actually felt like it's using quite a bit of resin, but I'm sure that's me just being a bit tight arse. It probably was a pound or two's worth of resin, which isn't nothing, but you should only have to run this test once, I guess, and then you should be able to key in your resin. So what you then do is look through the different prints and find the one that came out the best, and that hopefully should show you how many seconds to use exposure for this particular resin. One problem I did have is there seems a lot of what do they call it, like tear force applied when they're pulling these printed layers, these big flat printed layers off the FEP, and if the exposure time isn't enough, then it will start to peel away from the layers below. So, but I'm not sure how many things I'm going to print that are this big surface area, because that is quite a big surface area, and so that, I don't want to get into too much maths because I'm not sure I understand it that much, but it's based on like a square, and it's based on surface area, so the bigger the surface area, then it rises exponentially. So for example, 2 squared is 4 square centimeters, whereas 3 squared is 9, 4 squared 16, 5 squared 25. So as it starts to grow by small increments in its length and width, it grows massively in the surface area, and therefore the amount of force needed to tear it away, and that's where you start to get this. But I'm not that worried about tear force because I won't be printing things as flat and with as large surface area as this. So I'm basically looking for the best amount of detail, and I think where you can probably see it best is on this test here. So that's 1.6. This one here is 2.4, and then as you get further along the line, you can see that those squares are less defined. So I think it's probably somewhere between 1.5 and 3 is my sweet spot. This is 3.2, so maybe even between 1.6 and 2.4, something like that. So around 2, which is probably what the machine would have said anyway, because that's the kind of settings they tell you to use. So if I've got bigger areas and I need more adhesion to the previous print layer, probably more exposure, but somewhere about 2 is probably about right. So that was cool. As you can see, I've changed resin after the disappointment of trying to deal with the very detailed but very brittle Anycubic Basic Clear. So we're now gone for ABS like Elegoo resin plastic, and we reprinted the dwarves. Sadly, at the 12 stands, I did lose 2 again, but I did leave them on the bed overnight, and I really have to stop doing that because I'm sure that causes issues. So we printed 10 stands of these little Wario's. I have cured them, but I haven't cleaned these bits off, but they come off pretty easy. Like, I'm going to snap this one off here, look, while on camera. I mean, that's what we're talking about, to get a support off. You can't really see where it was attached. You might see a bit more damage on the base, but who cares? That's going to get based anyway, isn't it? So let's have a look at... I've got my painted lead belcher, or whatever it's called, gunmetal army painter spray, which is as rough as a bear's arse. And then I'll see if I can find the equivalent version in the plastic and see if you can see any real difference. As always, it's going to be hard to get these next to each other and in focus. To my untrained eye, I can't see a great deal of difference. I'm sure the ones on top maybe are slightly clearer, but it's very marginal, and I'm trading that off against the robustness of these fellas. So they do feel like they've got more give and more rigidity, if that makes any sense. So they've got a bit of give to them, but they're a lot stronger. So I think this ABS plastic is probably the way to go for little miniatures rather than that brittle resiny stuff. I've got the other one here, so this is the other. So there's probably enough detail for me there. I'm not the world's greatest painter, so even this level of detail will probably be something of a struggle to paint. Come on, get in focus. Getting this little support out here, I've got to try and remember to do that. I'm not sure I did it on the other ones, so here it is there. Let's see. Oh yeah, the support's still there, look. Hidden under his hammer. I have to remember to get that out. One thing I have done, since bringing it indoors, and obviously because I'm recording, I'm in the same room as the printer, and I've shut the window. And after only, I don't know what I've been recording, 5 minutes, but it's already, not even 5 minutes, it's already getting in my nose. So I'm gonna have to do something about that, maybe. Because it's not even running. It's just the smell of the resin in the room can be a bit stinky. So obviously when I'm not recording, I have the windows open. But and the heating on to keep it to the right temperature. So very environmentally friendly having the windows open and the heating on. But you can't have everything in this life. Next up, I wanted to be able to print my little tiny nids while attached to the print head. And in doing so, I realized that my wash cure machine and my Photon Mono aren't compatible. Who'd have thought it? So I had to print this big jig that they sent me the STL file for. It took quite about 4 hours, and it's quite a big lump. So this is the biggest piece I've printed, for sure. And I had to glue in a nut here for the print head to attach to with its bolt. So it needed a little bit of carving out because it was a little bit filled in and the nut wouldn't go in properly. So I can now wash my print head while it's got all the miniatures still attached, which is cool. And as I said, even though I was a little bit annoyed that they didn't provide this with the setup, the fact that now I've got this nice resin, it didn't take very long to produce, about 4 hours, a little bit of jimmy pokery to get this nut set in, so that without the nut it doesn't hold properly. There were no instructions to put the nut in. You do need to have a little bit of initiative in this game. So if something doesn't work, you think, well, what can I use to make it work? Oh, I just need to insert a nut in here. It looked like there was a hole for a nut. It just wasn't properly formed. It was a little bit underformed, or there's a little bit too much resiny material around it. So just file and carve that out, and then off we go. So I'm really happy about that. I'm going to print some little shooty Reno nids. I think there are eight lots. Is it eight lots of eight? That's a lot, isn't it? Eight lots of eight. Like 64 little tiny nids, all individually based. So a complete pain in the arse. So I'm going to wash them. I'm going to wash them on the head, and I'll let you know how that goes on. So we're back. We didn't lose any time whatsoever because of the power of Amazon. God damn him. So I ordered it on Thursday, it was here on Friday, and I was printing, the new resin was here on Friday, and I was printing again on Friday afternoon, Friday night. What a world we live in. So this is Saturday morning, this is episode 9. Yeah, things are back on schedule.